Welcome, Kristian Vigenin. You've been a member of the European Parliament and you're currently the Minister for Foreign Affairs in the Bulgarian government. How do you see the current situation in Europe? Because everybody's been talking of recovery and getting out of the economic situation that has dragged Europe down, but the real recovery, many would say, is yet to take place.
Well, definitely. Europe still faces a lot of challenges, and economic is one of them, but it's very much related also to the social developments, social inequalities, we can say as well, because usually we see Europe as a continent of wealth, but also the distribution of wealth is not so equal as you may expect. In some countries we see rising inequalities, and this is the result of the financial and economic crisis. So our message and the efforts that we are making is on one hand to achieve stronger growth, but this growth should be linked to employment creation, and the situation with unemployment, especially unemployment of young people, is really worrying in some countries where we have up to 50% youth unemployment. You can imagine that no society, no country has a future if the young people cannot integrate in the society. So recovery is somehow starting, but it's a long way until we achieve what we want. Strong economic growth, strong social development, strong employment creation, and then the rest will come. EU has a strong commitment to fulfill a number of long-term goals, the so-called Europe 2020 strategy. It cannot be achieved if we do not invest more in, for example, in education, in science, in growth of sectors which are related to new technologies. If we do not invest in renewables, for example, to be less dependent on energy imports from unstable regions. So all this in combination, if happens, will create a different view or different future for Europe.
But
is it possible?
Time,
let's hope.
But at the same time, do you think the population of Europe, generally speaking, is running out of patience? Do you think that is happening? Because you seem to have many right-wing parties getting more votes. You seem to have some sort of protectionism coming in different measures in different countries. So is it a question of now politicians like yourself having to worry about the future, or at least be concerned because time is running?
It's true that the economic crisis has added to the mistrust in the European project, in the European institutions. Somehow many people lost confidence in the possibilities or on the abilities of the European institutions to tackle these main challenges. Somehow they felt that Europe is able to invest billions to save banks, but is not able to invest billions to save people's employment, people to create future for the children of the citizens of Europe. So there is somehow the link between this political level and people became very weak. So now we have to restore that confidence, and the first opportunity to do that will be the European elections next year, end of May. Europe will vote for the next European Parliament, and you're absolutely right. We face enormous challenge, since in many countries of Europe we see populist, xenophobic, nationalist parties rising. They are in their essence, they're anti-European or Eurosceptic, which is the better option, but still many of them are anti-European. And the moderate political forces of the right wing and of the left wing have to have very clear message to the citizens, and should try to explain why it is important to vote in these elections and to make people vote for a realistic agenda. So the big fight we feel sometimes will not be between right and left in the next elections. it will be between anti-Europeans and pro-European political forces.
You feel that
for
Europe,
sure it will be very interesting. Very
you feel
interesting.
That the whole question of Europe as a European Union will be put out to the test. Is that what you're saying?
It will be a test to a high extent. I'm not afraid of prevalence of those anti-European forces, but I'm afraid that they will be much stronger than they were in the current format of the European Parliament. And if they're too strong inside, that of course is limiting the possibilities of the Parliament to work efficiently in favor of the development of the European project, because the others are simply against that project. There will be a majority in favor of European project, definitely. But
do you feel there's
any
chance?
It will be disappointing. It will be disappointing for somebody like me, for example, because we, especially in Central and Eastern Europe, we fought so much. We made so many sacrifices and we made so many reforms to be part of that EU. And suddenly, somehow, once we are there, the whole structure is put under question. So this is not the EU we wanted to join, you know. So now that's why we are trying to participate actively in the reformation of this project, finding the way to reach the people, to respond to their expectations, and
but
not so much to work for a project which is, somehow invented somewhere in Brussels.
But from your talk, it seems that there is a concern that the European Union may just crumble, and it may crumble from the inside, that people who are opposed may come in and then block everything, and then the whole project fails. Is that your concern?
Well, that threat is not imminent, let's say, but it's out there. So that is why I say that the moderate pro-European forces should try to restore their connection to people, and the European institutions should start taking much more into account the needs and the expectations of the people, and to care less about the bureaucratic issues which very often prevail in the discussions in Brussels. But that is why we, the politicians, are there to make this happen. And there is kind of, how can I say, people are waking up, politicians are waking up. So this challenge from the nationalists and anti-Europeans will have finally a healing effect on the EU project. That's why I'm a bit more optimistic than I sounded at the beginning, but it's a difficulty that we have to go through and to save our project.
Do you see a rise in racism in Europe?
I see it as a member of the European Parliament, for example. I led a working group created by the Socialist Group to combat the extreme right in Europe. I worked a lot on a number of countries and cases, and I see that in the past years this racism, nationalism, religious intolerance is rising, and sometimes we were not able to respond in the best possible way, because if this is happening very often, we are trying to respond to the consequences of these events, and not to the roots. Why is it happening?
Do you think the roots are economic? Because of the economic downturn, you have people who are opposed to foreigners coming in and taking away jobs, and it could be foreigners even from regions that are not too far away.
Yeah. It is there. It's true that mainly it's linked to economic and social difficulties of the people. And these nationalistic and xenophobic parties, they give very easy answers, which are wrong answers, but some people buy these answers, and they direct their discontent they direct that not in the right place. It's not the foreigners who are taking jobs, because actually if you look at the structure of the employment, for example, in most of the cases foreigners are taking jobs that none of the nationals is ready to take, definitely not for the level of payment that is offered. So actually foreigners contributed a lot to the development of European economy, especially the Western European and Northern European economies, which are strong, people are in principle try to go there to find their new future. And in some cases, it's about also for European citizens coming from Central and Eastern Europe, which become target of, incorrect political talk and campaigns against them. Very recently, for example, to be more precise, in a number of EU member states, the so-called transitional period of 7 years will expire, period in which Bulgarian and Romanian citizens had certain restrictions to work freely in those countries. And now in some countries, especially UK, there is a huge campaign of a xenophobic party there, which is quite high in the polls, with the support of a lot of yellow media. And it looks like we can't do much. I mean, on one hand, the authorities are very clear. There will be no restrictions anymore. These people are not a threat for us. They contribute a lot. But on the other, all these people are victimized. And at the same time, huge number of our immigrants, Bulgarian immigrants in UK, they are even not anymore immigrants because we have freedom of work within the EU starting 1st of January. They work in the financial institutions, they are high educated people, but somehow they are now victimized because of this kind of behavior. We can respond to this by explaining what are the real problems, what is the real situation. This way will deprive those nationalistic, xenophobic leaders and parties from the opportunity to simply lie people and make political capital out of that.
But apart from the internal situation of Europe, you're also now looking at immigration as an issue for the entire European Union. I mean this under the Schengen system, as well as member states who are, like yourself in Bulgaria, not part of the system as yet, but have your own immigration laws. Do you think there is likely to be a tightening on even non-immigrant visas for people who want to come in and work, for example, IT specialists, or even immigrants who want to come in and set up, let's say, shop or settle in the country because of the current economic problem and the rise of the nationalistic parties?
I think that there will be no tightening of the legal immigration. So that's something else. So the European Union understands very well that it needs, fresh forces to help the economies of the European Union. Our main concern is the illegal immigration and the increasing number of refugees coming from Northern Africa and the Middle East. This is an issue that we can hardly tackle, honestly speaking, and now even Bulgaria is facing enormous difficulties because now the immigration flows from Syria, which go through Turkey and reach even Bulgaria, are so high that we can hardly handle it. And that's why we're trying to now to work with other frontline countries, if I may say so, like Greece, Malta, Italy, to develop a more comprehensive strategy of EU to deal with this challenge.
What is that strategy that you're proposing?
Well, it means we are starting now the discussion on this. It means more solidarity between all member states with regard to these refugee flows and illegal immigration. It means that the burden should be shared by all member states because in reality, a big number of those people who are crossing Turkish-Bulgarian border, for example, they don't want to stay in Bulgaria. They want to go somewhere west or north, either to Germany or Sweden, countries which are known for their wealth and good care for immigrants. But at the same time, rules are such that they're registered in Bulgaria and they have to stay there. Even if they get a refugee status, they can go for some time somewhere else, but their first registration is Bulgaria. So from that point of view, uh, their hopes will not be fulfilled. But the question is that now, relatively a poor country, I say relatively because we are one of the countries with lowest GDP within EU, is taking a huge burden. We'll get certain support from the European Commission, but it's definitely not enough. We are seriously discussing the possibility of, first of all, increasing the support for those countries who are the primary target of the refugees and the illegal immigrants, and also to create a system where there is certain distribution also of the mid and long-term burden, so that some of the immigrants can be sent to other countries within the EU.
But you're not planning to stop the flow of immigrants and turn people away. Is that something you're also contemplating?
Well, we have no right to do that.
But there's no plan to do that.
I hope we cannot reach a situation that it will be definitely not possible anymore for us. It's not because we want to stop them, but we'll not be able to accommodate anymore those people. We do not have such a plan. But in reality, if this might be possible at our land border, it is definitely not possible when it comes to countries like Greece and Italy or Malta, which are have maritime border, and once people arrive there with their boats, you can't do much. So we should not stop it, but at the same time, this is, as I said, this is tackling the consequence in this case. What we should do is to try and invest more in security and stability and social and economic development in the countries of origin of this immigration on one hand, and on the other, which is now even more important, to make additional efforts to bring peace to Syria, because as long as there is a war there, people will try to find secure place for themselves and for their children. And if they cannot find refuge in the neighboring countries, which are already overburdened, they're trying to find to find refuge somewhere in the next, let's say, next circle, the other countries which are neighboring to the neighbors. And if this trend continues that way, what is happening now in Bulgaria, for example, but also Greece, Italy, Malta, it will be extremely difficult to tackle.
How close do you think is a solution on Syria?
How close? I hope it's rather close, because the agreement on the chemical weapons showed that when there is political will, when the international community and the main players agree, and when they understand that there is no other way, because otherwise the consequences of inaction will be even bigger, then agreement is possible and things are happening. I hope that now, it's the more difficult part now, but the first step is done. So I hope that now we can seriously expect soon a second conference, peace conference on Syria, which will create more or less the roadmap for the next steps. If this happens, then I believe peace will come back to Syria, which again doesn't mean that people will return immediately back to Syria, because a lot of cities, villages are completely destroyed. People have nowhere to live, nowhere to work. So the rebuilding of Syria is the next huge challenge after we bring the peace, and it will take years.
You started working in politics at a very young age. You've in fact been a member of the European Parliament, and currently you are with the government in your own country. Do you feel that as a European, you will perhaps go back to the European Parliament next time around? Is that something that you're contemplating? Because you are very involved with Europe.
Well, I would say that I would be ready to go back, because I have the experience and I know how to use my positions in the European Parliament to develop the European project and to develop the relations between EU and the world, because I was also focused in the foreign affairs area there. But you know, I'm starting now my 6 month as a minister, so I plan to stay in the executive for some time, and then I'll think about the rest. Now I focus on being successful as foreign minister, and I hoped that one of the achievements of my ministry while I'm leading it will be a strong development of relations with Asia and in particularly with India. So that in 2 or 3 years, looking back, I can be satisfied of what I have achieved here. And for the rest, it's too early to think about this.
We wish you luck and thank you for sharing your views with us.
Thank you.
Good luck.